Terima kasih teman-teman sekalian sudah berada di sini untuk menyaksikan ceramah dari Ibu Yannick Lintz. Sebelum acaranya dimulai, kami mohon teman-teman untuk mematikan dari telepon, tidak makan, minum, atau berbicara selama acara berlangsung. Setelah acara nanti, kita akan ada forum tanya-jawab yang akan dipandu oleh Lisa Bonarahman. Dan sebelumnya itu, program ceramah Yannick Lintz ini didukung oleh Institut Français Indonesia yang Bapak Christian Gozak akan memperkenalkan mengenai program ini.
Salamat malam, bonsoir. Thank you for coming, so many of you. And young people, Mrs. Lintz was just telling to me in France, in a conference, we would have old people. So we like you, because you are young. Thank you. the French Embassy and the Pusat Kebudayaan Prancis di Jakarta, di Indonesia, Jakarta, have the pleasure to welcome Mrs. Lintz. Mrs. Lintz is the director of the Department of Islamic Art of Museum Le Louvre in Paris. I don't think that I am a nationalist if I say that it is the biggest museum in the world. And I met Mrs. Lintz in November in Paris, and I asked her if she could come to Indonesia to give conferences, to meet Indonesian audience, students, and experts in Islamic art. And also, she had today and yesterday meetings with the government of Jakarta and also the Jakarta Islamic Center. Because there, maybe you will see in the press that there is a project, Duaribu de la Panbilas, of the opening of a museum of Islamic art in Indonesia. So we hope that this first visit of Mrs. Lintz in Jakarta, in Indonesia, will help this museum to be open. After Jakarta, Mrs. Lintz will go to Yogyakarta. I think she's very lucky because she will visit the secrets of the Sultan Palace on Saturday. I haven't visited, maybe neither you. And before going to Jakarta on Thursday night, she will participate in an event organized in Tamrin, IFI Tamrin, called Nuit des Idées, the Night of the Ideas. International event aimed to exchange, debate Indonesian and French intellectuals, artists, experts on a common world, what can be common for us coming from different countries, from different cultures. So I leave Madame Lintz to give her conference. Thank you very much to come tonight.
So thank you. I feel very honored to be here today evening and it's not a commonplace for me to be like a star movie here in front of you. So I would like, through my choice of about 50 objects of Islamic art, to think with you about a question that can seem simple, but which is rather difficult. The question is, what is Islamic art? Why do I ask the question? I'm sure that many of you here, if you ask yourself this question, you don't have maybe a lot of answers. And as director of the Islamic art department in the Louvre, a new department that opened in 2012, we now have welcomed about 3 million visitors that came to see our Department of Islamic Art. And we are very lucky in the Louvre Museum because we have a special department devoted to social inquiries about the visitors, their reactions after their visits. So we know now those visitors come from all over the world, as you can imagine. And we know that around 85% of those visitors do not understand what they see. They don't understand what is Islamic art, what they see. So you can imagine that for me, it becomes the main question to develop when I have an audience in front of me. A second point, which is of course specific here in Jakarta, is, and I try to discover here, what can be Islamic art in Indonesia. But what I will show you here is Islamic art on an European point of view, which is another story that I will try to tell you this evening. There is a problem. I will do like this. So I would like to develop shortly. After we can of course discuss, and you can have all the questions you want. But I would like to explain it on three perspectives. The first one: what is Islamic art as a global concept? Second point: a regional perspective, and third and last point, Islamic art in relation with European art, which is, of course, in the Louvre, a main concept. So, what is Islamic art as a global concept? Maybe you don't know it, but when we say Islamic art, it's not a term used by the main actors of this art history. It means that it was not a concept used by the Arabs, for instance, or by the Iranians. But this concept of Islamic art was invented in Europe in the end of the 19th century, beginning of 20th century, by all the collectors and scholarships that started to travel in the East or in North Africa. It was during the colonialism time, and so all this new interest for the East or for the south of Mediterranean was also a discovery of this civilization, and for those new scholars or those new collectors that very quickly started to collect things, to buy things in all those countries. So the concept for them was Islamic art, because, or sometimes you can see also Muslim art when you see books edited end of the 19th century or beginning of the 20th. It's very funny to see that in the same time, for instance, in Cairo, they created the first museum called today Islamic Art Museum, but at this time in 1903, it was called National Museum of Arabic Art. So, you see that this concept is a European concept, which is something very strange. I'm still here. Yeah. So, what I wanted, when we say it's a global concept coming from Europe and dating from the end of the 19th century, the other question is, but So the concept is created, but what is really Islamic art? So I try to explain it in a few concepts. Of course, it's never easy. You would ask me to give a definition of what is European art in two or three sentences. It would be also a very difficult exercise. So I will try to start by one concept that is not the most evident. I don't know here what is your opinion, but in Europe, when you say Islamic art is figurative art, everyone says it's not possible because it's religious art, so it cannot be figurative because you cannot have figuration. And so it's the beginning of a wrong story about what is Islamic art. So I will start to show you how this art can be and is mainly figurative. So sorry, the quality of the image is not so good. So you will have to come to the Louvre to see the original one, which is so beautiful. Maybe also I would say that mainly all the pieces you will see here is a choice of the Louvre collection, which is the most important collection in the world of Islamic art. So we have, I should say, the treasures of this civilization. So maybe you don't see it so well, but it's an ivory box. We can see pixies, but in fact it's a box. A box that was made, as you can see, in Spain, near Cordoba, Medina al-Zahra. Cordoba, as you may know, was a main capital of the beginning of Islam in the west part of Islam. Of course, the first big cities that were created by the new Arabs, Muslims, were Damascus and Baghdad. But after the conquest of the west of the Mediterranean, the city of Cordoba in south of Spain became also for many decades a capital of political capital, religious capital, and artistic capital. But I will not describe in detail this box. I could take 1 hour to describe the detail. But I wanted to show you this box as one of the examples of what is figurative art in Islamic art. It shows, I hope that you can maybe see. I will try to show you through the computer. So you see here, or maybe here, or here. So the central scene is always a scene with two young men, and those two young men are in fact two princes that are fighting for the power. One of them is the prince Al-Murira from the Cordoba dynasty. The other is a prince from the Abbasid dynasty from Baghdad. And what is interesting, I will not tell you all the story, but just to show you, so it's a real theatrical organization, like in the theater, of those two princes, always one against the other, and the message is a political message. This box was done to give to Al-Murira prince, and the message we can... The political message in this box is really to say to Al-Murira, you will be the next prince against the Abbasid prince. So just to tell you, when we say Islamic art is figurative art, it is, for example, political messages on those boxes. And I choose to start by those type of subjects because another simple idea and wrong idea we can have about Islamic art is to imagine that Islamic art is only religious art. You can see here that, like in European art, like in all over the world art in other civilizations, political messages are part of the art patterned by the princes. So other type figurative art, we go more east of Mediterranean, southeast of Mediterranean. This basin, which is a basin, you see the size is really about 70 centimeters large. This basin is in the Islamic Art Department, our Mona Lisa. It's called, on a strange title, the Baptistery of King Saint Louis, which was one of the French kings going to participate to the Crusaders. And this basin is typical of, I should say, Egyptian art. We know the name of the artist. I wrote it here, Mohammed Ibn al-Zayn. He was a very famous artist in Cairo during the 14th century, so during the Mamluk dynasty. But it's interesting to know, even if it's not the reason of my choice here, but to know why it is called the Baptistery of the French King. It's a nice story because Saint Louis took this basin given by the Mamluk Sultan during the Crusaders, took it to France, and it became the baptistery for all the French kings. It's a nice story for me because it's also a way to illustrate that there is not always a rupture between Islamic art and European art, or between Islamic art and European collectors. And European collectors, even the French kings of the medieval time, loved very often this type of art. But here, it's always to illustrate my subject of Islamic art is a figurative art. You see, I'm sorry, not so good, but you can guess that all the basin, outside and inside, is like a cartoon. It's a storytelling, and the storytelling of the life of the Sultan during the 14th century in Cairo. And you see inside and outside, the in the circles, like here, this is the Sultan and all the court, the servants, the warriors around him, and in different type of scenes of his life, when he goes to hammam, when he has banquets, when he goes hunting, for instance. So it means that Islamic art is mainly like European art, this art that you can see, I should say high-level art. We are not here in more ethnographical production. We are really in very high level, what we can call royal art in a certain way. It means either decorative architecture or luxury wares for the tables, and that illustrates mainly either the box, the Spanish box, or this Egyptian metalware basin, the life of the kings, of the queens, of the sultans, of the princes. Other type of iconography, here, it's a plate typical from the beginning of Islam, 9th century, coming from Iran. And I think you can, we see that it's a sort of naive style. It's the beginning of figurative art in Islam. And you can guess, I think, you can see a horseman holding a big flag, and it's typical of those warriors of the beginning of the Islamic conquest going to west. And we know about those flags, those very big flags that were held by the chief of the army. We have original flags in textiles. We have in our collection, but we know in other countries, in Morocco, for instance. So we know about those flags that had the chief or the warrior during an important fight against the Christians. And it's also an image used and very often used in the beginning of Islam in those new ceramics, in those new luxury vessels, in a new technique invented also in the beginning of Islam, which is lustreware, this specific ceramic with an effect of metal with reflects on the brown colors that you don't see here. So, over time, over place, but Islamic art has an important school of painting. When I say such a thing to my colleagues in the Louvre, colleagues of the painting departments that are responsible of Leonardo da Vinci, of all those big painters from European art, they just look at me and say, what? Islamic art has paintings? Of course, when we say paintings, it means mainly this tradition of painting of miniatures on manuscripts. But it's a real specific history of art. We could really write a history of painting in Islamic art. And here, as an example of a figurative subject in these paintings, I chose a love story, a very famous love story coming from literature, because you know, I'm sure, or you may know, that Islamic culture in Middle East, very soon after the beginning of Islam, developed a very rich literature. And not only a literature about the prophet, of course, also about the prophet, but not only. Poetry is something that becomes very important in Islamic culture. And this poetry was also illustrated in the manuscripts of those stories by very important artists and very important painters. So here you have the painters. Is now you are in a very important school of painting in Burara, in the oasis of Burara in Uzbekistan, Central Asia. We are in the middle of the 16th century. It's one of the highest school of painters at this time, all around the Islamic world, I should say. And this painter, very famous painter, represents a love story between Majnun and Layla. It is the couple, and here with a specific scene of Majnun, the boy, but takes Layla dogs, and so we have many other scenes of Majnun and Layla that was very famous. Other very interesting image of figurative art. We are here in India. The portrait of the Mughals emperor, Jahangir, holding the portrait of his father, the emperor Akbar. And I chose this image because for me, it's more a European painting than Islamic or Indian painting, because the art of the self-portrait or the art of a portrait is typical of European art history or European paintings art history. You see the beginning of the portraits during the late Middle Age and beginning of Renaissance. But it's not at all in Islamic art a tradition until the 17th century, and more specifically in India, because the Indian Mughals, emperors, were fascinated by European paintings. And so in their, maybe you know that Wu's painting is not a big painting. It's something like 20 centimeters. And the idea of the Mughals about Wu's paintings was to create their own museums. It means their own album or book in which they collected images painted by very famous artists. And they wanted to have some portraits of their ancestors and of themselves. So it's very, it's maybe not evident when we see it, because it's in a very Indian style, but the concept of the painting is really a figurative portrait, like in European art. So, to go quickly in this idea of Islamic art as a figurative art, other type of scenes, always in the idea of whose images come from palaces and from the life of the kings, the queens, the emperors, the sultans. Here you have, it's a very big panel, you see here the size, coming from Isfahan, which was the capital of the Safavid dynasty. We are in Iran between 16th century and 18th century, so we could say in the modern period. We are not in the beginning of Islam, we are not in the Middle Age. It's the modern part of this art history. But you see here, as I told you before, the two people sitting, one facing the other, are just fighting with poetry. They try each one to create poems and to write it as a calligrapher. So it's also interesting to see that those images of Islamic art shows here also the life of the prince, but the life of the prince or of the king is not the same when you are in Cairo during the 14th century, like the Bassin, or when you are in Isfahan during the 17th century. And last image of figurative art as Islamic art, you also have dancers. Today, it's an ivory coming from Iraq, and that was made in Cairo for the Abbasid king of Baghdad. And you can see on your right, there is a musician on the left and a dancer on the right. I can tell you that today, when I try to say to the audience that I can have in front of me that Islamic art can't show dancers, they don't believe me. So, of course, very quickly, more traditionally, we imagine Islamic art, and it's right, it's also an art of calligraphy, of arabesque. Arabesque is a word used from the beginning of this study of Islamic art in the end of the 19th century. We usually don't know really what it is, so I will try to show it quickly. Calligraphy, I chose two pieces from the beginning of Islam. The one down is not really a piece of art, but it became a treasure because it's the only one known in all the world today. It may be the first stone, milestone, that was used on the roads of this new empire, the first new Islamic empire of the Umayyad king Abdel Malik. And it was found in the region of Jerusalem, and it's maybe the first inscription in Arabic language. It's a sort of design, even if we can't, they were not conscious at this time to make calligraphy, which is really an art, a visual art. So the wood piece that you have here on your left is more typical of this art of calligraphy. Of course, I will not explain in detail, but an important part of calligraphy in Islamic art is present in the architecture. And of course, mainly in religious architecture, like the new monuments that were created by the new civilization of Islam, like the mosques, but also the tombs or the mausoleum, if we are more east in Iran. So there is, maybe you know it, there is a lot of type of calligraphy, usually very characteristic of time, of the history. It's not the same calligraphy in Egypt in the beginning of Islam, during the Fatimid time, or in Iran during the 19th century. So there is all different style of calligraphy. But what is interesting is that this tool, this artistic tool, was used mainly in architecture and in the manuscripts. But not only, because you see here also a nice faience, blue and white, but it's not influenced by China. But you can maybe, everyone can feel that there is a sort of game for the artist to create a design which is more than just writing. There is an inscription, but we feel very obviously that the artist try really to play with this calligraphy and to do something very visual. Other type of design on calligraphy, you can't read it, but it's so I mean about the design you see on the top of the document, which is an Ottoman deed, an Ottoman contract signed by the Sultan. And there is typical of the Ottoman calligraphy, what we call the tougra, which is the way in through which, in a very concentrated design, each Ottoman sultan invented himself, as a calligrapher, his own tougra. Of course, it's also more traditional to speak about Islamic art as geometric art, and I will not develop this idea. I chose two types of geometric design. But we can ask ourselves the question, why geometry, why so much geometry in Islamic art? We find geometry in European art, but not before the 20th century. Here you see we are in the 14th century. So geometry is part of Islamic art, and the main reason, and we could of course demonstrate it, but the main reason is that Islamic civilization developed during the medieval time a very important part of the science, and of algebraic science, mathematics science, geometry science. And so those artists were in the same prince court or king court than the artists. So the artists and the scientists lived together and inspired together and discussed together. So this is a good example of what we can call arabesque. When I was a young student, and when my teacher told me about arabesque in art, I never know really what it was. I knew that it was a lot of lines in all type of direction. But it's interesting to see on your left, it's a very good example of inspiration of those artists. The main priority is not to do a bird. The main priority is to do like here, to fool all the surface of the wood and to do some very decorative art. But the artist tried to play with those lines in all directions. And in fact, he wanted to create a bird. And we see that we can't, it's not here really figurative art, because you don't have a bird on one side, flowers on the other. It's the main purity is really the decorative lines on all the surface. But you see that here, the foot of the birds are included in the top of the flower. So it's not really realistic figuration. And of course, Islamic art is also religion art. But as you understood, I didn't start by this definition, because I try also not to be so traditional in this definition. So of course, religious art, because like in European art, you have art for the churches, and so the subjects are in link with the rules inside the religious monument. It's the same for Islamic culture. You need specific art, so not with the life of the prince, but with the idea of the Quran, and so you need to read and to write the Quran and some surat of the Quran on different decorative objects of the mosque, and here a very famous series of lamps coming from Egypt with very precise unemailed glass. And of course, as I told you, religious art is also on tombstone. I don't see the same here. And so here it's the mosque lamp, and here is a tombstone from the Shiite tradition, so coming from Iran. And of course, you also have religious art developed in Iran, in the Shiite context, of tiles of decorative architecture with not only Surat of the Quran, but in those mausoleums of Shiites, you have also poems, and very nice poems. And of course, we also have a representation of the life of the prophet. I chose here two stories, and it's a central question people ask me usually, can we see the prophet in Islamic art? My answer is yes, but it depends when and where. And here I chose a time of art history, which is an example of this pleasure the artist had to represent life of the prophet. It's in Turkey during the 16th century. And still in the Ottoman time, we have also very interesting panel of ceramics that were included in the monuments. You see the type of monuments of the Ottoman time with those very typical tiles of green and red and white colors. And usually this Ottoman style is Arabesque style, so non-figurative style, but you have in some mosques, but also in some palaces, given by the owners of the monument, the representation of Mecca. And to finish with this Islamic art as a global concept, you should not forget that Islamic art is art coming from the Islamic world. And the Islamic world is not only Muslims. In all the countries, during all time of Islam, from the beginning until today, you have different communities. And I chose here a candlestick coming from Syria, from the Middle Age, and with, you don't see it really precisely, but you have Christian scenes. So you have Christian or Jewish iconography. It's another debate, but Jewish iconography is not with images, but we have Islamic art objects in the collection coming from Jewish synagogue with Hebraic inscriptions. And here you have Christian scenes. So, very quickly, because I see that time goes on. Another thing, as I told you, Islamic art is a European concept that started in the end of the 19th century. But, in fact, what is more and more interesting to understand when we try to see on Islamic art is the regional challenges, and there are real regional specific history. So I will just very quickly show you the images of those different regional styles. That means Arabic art, Iranian art, Turkish art, Indian art, and Chinese influence. So Arabic art is, I will not give you every time a definition of what is Arabic art, what is Iranian art. Of course, there is a common language. That's why I try to explain you this common language. But we can see very specific styles of regional styles. Here I chose a capital coming from Algeria, from the Middle Age, and what is typical is that you will never see this in Syria or even in Iran, because it's a tradition of decoration coming from the Roman style in North Africa, because you have in Algeria, Morocco, Tunisia, a lot of Roman city from the antiquity, and it's a real local tradition. So it's interesting to see that even with the beginning of Islam, with a new culture, with a new international culture, the art process makes a reality. It's still, you can also see it in Europe. It's that the prominence of the artist and the influence of their cultural heritage of the past still remains, even if they have an international language. Oh, so yeah, sorry, you didn't see the capital before. So other type of style, this type of painting on metal in a certain way, which is inlaid metalware, like the Battistery I showed you, is typical of the techniques and the style you see in Syria during the Middle Age, during the Crusader periods. I showed you also the candlestick of the Christian scenes. It's the same region, the same type. Someone that knows a little about Islamic art will never tell you it's coming from Iran. They will tell you it's Syria. It's really Arabic tradition. Same with this Sultan Osman, which is a Sultan from Syria, from the same time. What is typical, of course, is the dress he has, the way he's dressed, and the type of technique. You never see such a technique in Iran. You will find again such a technique during the Ottoman time in Turkey, but 3 centuries after. So, a few images of Iran, but when we say Iran for Islamic art history, it's not Iran inside the borders of the country today. The Iranian word in Islamic culture means the same culture from Afghanistan through Central Asia to western part of Iran, even sometimes on the east borders of Iraq. So this is true in all history of civilization. The borders, the present borders are not the same. So when we say Iranian culture or Iranian art in Islamic art, it means a big region. And those 3 pieces, ceramics and an incense burner that you will see here, which is the real objects of the detail you see of the head of the different slides. So those type of ceramics, the type of decoration, more than the technique, and the incense burner in metal, you can't, no one in Arabic country, in Near East, knows those techniques, those type of decoration. During the beginning of Islam, we are here around the 11th, 12th century. So when we see this, we know that we are in the east part of Iran. But we have also west part of Iran with more typical design or more typical style. This type of this type of ewer with a rooster head, it's typical Iranian, and I will not explain you why you don't find this subject of the rooster head in Syria, but it's always you will find some answers in thinking of the cultural heritage of the past traditions. In Iran, you have a real tradition, like here, I discover Islamic art with Hinduism influences. In Iran, you still have Zoroastrianism, which is pre-Islamic, but it's still very full of tradition inside the Islamic time. So quickly, to finish on Iranian style, this box is a very rare box coming from a region of western Iran called Fars, and it's a very religious region with a lot of Shiit mausoleum, and so you can even found metalware in shape of mausoleum, and of course the art of textiles, of carpets, you know, are very typical and are very different from one region to another. So Turkish art, of course, the main Turkish art, or the most famous, is the Ottoman art from this big empire that started in the beginning of 16th century. When we say Ottoman Empire, you shouldn't forget that it's not Turkey of today. It includes all Near East and to Egypt also. So it's the I should say the east part of Mediterranean with a very precise style. I could have show you some typical Isnik style of ceramics, but I wanted to show you those very typical inlaid jade with Chinese influence, of course. Indian art, just one images, but what can be also typical as a regional art like India are the materials. The materials, of course, India, as you know, is rich in precious stone, in jade, also in rubies, in emeralds. So, of course, the art, the royal art, will be influenced by those typical regional materials. And the Chinese influence, which is not a regional style, but to show you that Islamic art is the result of a lot of process, a global process of a culture, a regional process, as I just wanted to show you, and process of influences. You know it, China will be a big source of inspiration, either in techniques, like we can see here in this Iranian bowl, typical of Chinese ceramic techniques, or this very famous blue and white style. But what is also interesting is that I could discuss today afternoon with the curator of the National Museum. She told me, oh, you know, we have some blue and white Iranian ceramics with Chinese influence. And I told her that you also have this same influence in Syria decoration. So this Chinese influence went to Iran, but also to Near East. And of course, the here with the dragon, it's also... So to finish my third point, Islamic art in relation with European art. In fact, it's the counterpoint, in a certain way, of the influence, of the Chinese influence. But for us in the Louvre, it's a very important question to trying to explain to the European visitors Islamic art from a European point of view and showing them some same techniques or same subjects. For instance, you have here the very famous church called Saint-Denis, which is in the north of Paris and which was historically the Royal Burials Church. So all the treasures coming from those royal burials are now in the Louvre. And here it's very interesting to see that this treasure, called Treasure of Saint-Denis, has either Islamic piece or Western piece. Here you have a label, but if you don't have this label, I would have tried to play with you and to make you guess what is Islamic art in, between those two pieces and what is Western art. So you have part of the answer because this is Islamic art, but in the same type of techniques that this candlestick, it's a rock crystal with golden metal decoration. But this is typical of the Islamic production in Egypt during the Fatimid time, it means in the beginning of Islam, in the beginning of the new city of Cairo. It was the best artists were at this time in Egypt, and all the Christian cathedrals or the kings tried to buy those very famous rock crystal pieces making in Egypt. So it is Islamic art, even if it was for a Christian owner. And this was in the same collection, in the same royal collection, and it was done for the Queen Eleonore d'Aquitaine, French king, French queen, and it was done in Italy. So it's totally European art. And we can also see the same technique. Usually we say, maybe you remember my horseman with this flag in the beginning of the conquest of Islam. And it was done in Iraq with a new technique, usually said as very specific of Islamic art, this lustreware, but in fact, the same technique will be used in European art made during the 15th century in Manises, south of Spain, and for Christian owners by Christian artists. So it's what we can call European art. Here, I wanted to show you an image of a part of the Louvre, which is a second Louvre. You know that we make a lot of babies around the world. We have the Louvre Abu Dhabi soon. And we have a Louvre in France, in north of France, Louvre Lens. And we try to present those type of comparison. And here, this box that you see here better is like the box I show you in the beginning of my slides. So it's really Islamic art, Arabic art from Spain. from the time of Cordoba as a capital of Islam in Western world. And here, in the same type of work, in the same time also, from workshop of South Italy. And it's very interesting when you go inside the life of those artists at this time to see that you had at this time, it means around the 10th century, so beginning of the Middle Age, Muslim artists working in Spain, but if they can earn money, they are also businessmen and they go to South Italy, it's not far, both South Spain, South Italy. And so you have the same artist working for European context or Islamic context. And last image, very interesting also, we just acquired last year in the department a celestial globe in paper with a lot of drawing. We know that through this inscription that it was done for Safavid Shah, Al-Sultan Shah, Sultan Hussein. So we are really in the end of the 17th century, beginning of 18th century, and it's not at all the Islamic tradition of representation of the planets, but it's the Western inspiration, and that's why I wanted to show you this European globe which comes from the National Library in Paris, which was made in 1715. And it's interesting to see that the Safavid kings were fascinated by the European science of their time. And so for them, and astrology was part of this new science in Europe, in Netherlands, in fact. And so they wanted to have, as a royal collection in Safavid court, some inspiration of European astrology, but made by Islamic artists. So thank you. I was very long, and I hope that you understand maybe better, or maybe not, about Islamic art. So, of course, I can answer to all your questions if you have some questions.
My name is Diaz. Actually, I have two questions, but it will seem too greedy, so I will just ask you one question. I was wondering, how do European scholars, art scholars, few Islamic arts that is not Arabic, for example, Indonesian Islamic arts? Thank you.
I hope that I understand your question. So you would like to know why Indonesian art is not Islamic art for the European, is it?
No.
Islamic art historians don't know anything about Islamic art in Southeast Asia. I could tell you, but I wrote to a colleague today, very famous colleague, Syrian colleague in MIT University in Boston, and I told him that I am in Jakarta, and he answered me, "Oh, wonderful. For the first time, some Islamic art historians try to understand Islamic art in this region." So it's not at all a tradition. Of course, we could ask ourselves why, because Islam arrives here in the same time as in Central Asia, which is the Iranian world, as I told you. But I think that for the academics, for the scholarships who started, who started to study this art in the
end of the 19th century, they really tried to focus on what they could see. And those scholarships, because it was the tradition at this time, traveled to Egypt, traveled to North Africa, traveled to Iran because there were diplomatic relations between France and Iran, and we had from 1876 an agreement with the Iranian Empire to work on archaeology, etc. So I think that it's part of the explanation. We don't have, as you know, a real tradition of archaeology in Southeast Asia. So it's part of the explanation.
It evokes a curiosity in me as to why the audience don't believe it when you told them that Islamic only have dancers. Yeah, I'm kind of curious. Why you didn't believe in your audience when you told them that Islamic art actually have dancers?
Has dancers? I don't know. I will be very naive. I don't know what is your context here, your cultural or social context. But I can tell you that now in Europe, in France, people don't have a very positive image of Islam, and so they think that Islam cannot be compared with joy, with good life. It has to be very strict, very religious. So we have a lot of wrong idea because of the context, of the international context of war, of jihadism, etc. So people have in Europe have no culture about Islam, and I should say, not only European people, because I was also in Cairo a few weeks ago, and I did a lecture, and even for other, I see for other public audience in Arabic countries, in Iran, people do not know the history, do not know art history, and so they are just react to what they think they know. That's the reason, and so it's not. The image, I could show images where some Muslims drink also sometimes wine in other time of the story, because it was the culture at this time in a specific place. So it's not natural today to imagine all the different subjects. I would like also to say, I would not like you to think that it's only dance, etc. I think that you could see you have both. You have a very religious context and you have more royal life context, which is life.
Just want to, so we can see from your presentation here that Islamic art is very diverse and very rich. But I was wondering, is there any Louvre artifact from the early beginning of the Islam, from the Prophet Muhammad, pace? I think it's about from the 600 to 700. Because there's no evidence from the we don't see the artifact from the Prophet age, which is the figurative or decorative artifact. Is there any?
There are some archaeological artifacts or ethnographical artifacts of the time of the Prophet, but you don't have artistic artifact. The beginning of Islamic art is not at the time of the Prophet in the desert or in Mecca, in Medina. It's in Damascus, in the first Islamic and Arabic capital, the first monument, Islamic monument, is the Damascus Great Mosque or the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem. So that's why we try in the beginning of the department to explain to the visitors from where does it come from. So we try to show more the artistic influence in different part of the Islamic work of the late antiquity, but not of time of the prophet, because it's not really the beginning of art.
Thank you. To be honest, I was actually surprised when I heard China. You said China. I seem to forgot that Islam has reached China. But I want to focus in Europe. I'd like to know how was the distribution or the circulation of the arts itself in the continent, because I always divide Europe in Nordic countries, Eastern Slavs, mainland and Latin countries. How were the arts circulated?
You have different storytellings. During medieval time, you had very important time, which are the Crusaders, and war means also cultural and business exchanges. So it was a time in which the Christians present in Near East started to discover between two fights the nice pieces of art, and those people were from the aristocracy, and so they like art. Usually aristocrats likes to collect, and so it's one type of the story. As I told you, there is another one in the same period, which is the relation between South Italy and Spain, because you have the very natural commercial exchanges, and so whenever you have commercial exchanges, you can imagine that you have cultural exchanges. And you also have another reason of Islamic art now in France, or French collection, is the diplomatic relations, for instance, between the Ottomans and the German Empire from Habsburg Empire. So that's why you have a lot of Turkish carpets in Germany, for instance. But you also have a fascination for the Iranian dynasty, as I told you about Safavids during 17th, 18th century, and after the Qajar during 19th century. There was a lot of relation with France, so they, after diplomatic visits, they left every time very nice gifts, and those diplomatic gifts are also part of those collection. And of course you have during the 19th century and after, all the travelers, individual travelers, or some going during the French colony in north of Africa, Morocco, for instance, and when they came back after independence, they took objects with them.
My question relates to the role of Louvre as a museum. So it's really fascinating for me to hear that you mentioned around 3 million people already visited your department since 4 years ago. Now, you said that 85% of them don't really know what is Islamic art. Now, what is the story that you wanted to tell as the leader of this department? Is it do you think, you know, the museum has a role to play in fostering an understanding, or because 3 million people is a lot of people, so yeah, what do you have to say about that? Thank you.
We usually speak, when we speak about the Louvre, we usually speak about a universal culture museum. It was the big idea of the 18th century, the Enlightenment time. So we are still a universal culture museum. So my storytelling in the Islamic Art Department that I want to tell to the visitors is more or less what I try to tell you here, is to understand really, to give some keys, trying to better understand on a visual point of view what they see. Of course, no, the non-Arabic or non-Muslim people will not read the calligraphy, etc. But to have some general keys on those cultures and on this civilization, and also to understand it's part of the storytelling. Why is so? It was your question. Why do we found Islamic art in Paris, in the Louvre? From where does it come from? Who were the owners? And it's, I think, also an important part of the storytelling. And I don't want to be too long, but you see, one difficult question for us is about the French Muslims, because it should be also, we could imagine that it could be a place of cultural identity for French Muslims. It is not. Why? Because the main part of French Muslims are from North Africa, Morocco, Tunisia, Algeria. And we do not have a lot. I showed you a capital from Tlemcen, from Algeria. But in fact, we don't have a lot of objects coming from this region, because the French, when they were there, when they were the rulers, tried to open the museums there. So we didn't take the collections, and we cannot show, it's a paradox for us, we cannot show a lot of Morocco art, of Algerian art, for those French Muslims that have mainly this identity.
My question is probably related to the first question, how to identify Islamic art outside those regions that you just mentioned. I mean, for example, do we go to Southeast Asia or South Africa, for example? I believe that there are some part of, you know, Islamic art that is defined and specific to that region. So how to identify or to recognize Islamic art in this region? And probably second question, if I may, I'm just wondering what's the interesting image that you projected there?
Yeah.
Yes.
So I would answer to the second question first. It's the detail of an object you saw very quickly as an incense burner coming from the road of incense, and it was made during the 11th century east part of Iranian world. So, but I love this object. It's one of my favorites. So I just show you the head, but. So it's not easy for me, I don't know for you, but it's not easy to identify Islamic art here. It's the exercise I started yesterday by visiting your museums, and I have some answers. Of course, what is religious is easy. For instance, I was in Batavia today, in the old palace of Gouverneur Palace, I don't find, so you see the museum, the main museum, and I saw a wonderful minbar from the 16th century. For me, it's Islamic art. When I see Quran, illustrated Quran, for me, it's Islamic art. So I get familiar with Islamic art in religious context. It's more difficult in more private context of the royal society or the aristocratic society. I understood that for me, it's still a lot of questions. What existed or still exists from the beginning of Islam until 16th century? What are the production? I didn't see any old Quran, for instance, and I'm sure that we could find Quran here during 12th century, 13th century, so it's still a question for me. I see that it becomes clear after the during the 16th century, 17th century, I see that the kings have some royal objects. I saw ceramics in Dutch style, but with Arabic inscription inside. So for me, it's typical of something of Islamic culture. So I start to have some questions, but it's like a puzzle. And I think that to answer to this question, it needs time and it needs to see collections. I try like a hunter to see. For me, it's impossible not to find some old Quran. For instance, I would like to see what was the paintings inside. But it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. Maybe can I just conclude on this question? I hope that there are maybe, or there will be, in the new generations in Indonesia, some art historian specialized in Islamic art, and because if we want to be very serious, it needs a lot of work to understand also the roads of the productions of the artists. So you have also to go to written sources to understand what was the artistic context.
I'm curious to know the relationship between the science and mathematical development to art, particularly in Abbasid period. For instance, in Alhambra Palace, the development of proportion and such, etc.
Yes, I couldn't develop when I showed you two pieces of geometric artifacts, but it's the, for instance, the art of what we call zellige in Morocco style, or in Mamluk time, not too much during Abbasid time, but really it started more during 13th century, 14th century, so in Morocco, and in Egypt, because there were the good scientists, the good we have some books of geometry and of art of geometry, and so when you try to understand the composition of those panels, wood panels or ceramic panels, you really see that you need to know geometry to have some calculation to organize the decoration. It's not just inspiration. It's something that you have to draw before painting or before cutting, and you need to use the rules, the scientific rules, to put it on a wall or on a panel. So I will not to make you the demonstration. I need more images and to show you the link between what we see in the books of those scientific people living at this time in Morocco, south of Spain, but also in Cairo. It was the center of the science.
So the question is, I hope you can understand what I say. The question is, we all know before the conquest of Constantinople, Istanbul, the Hagia Sophia was a church. Hagia Sophia was a church, and after the conquest, it becomes a mosque. And there is a medallion, two medallions. And between the medallions, there is a painting of Saint Mary, the mother of Jesus. And there is a Arabic calligraph in the painting. So the question is that the Islamic art of European art?
It's not the same case. The two situations are very different. The process of a church becoming a mosque, it's not only for Hagia Sophia in Istanbul. It was the case of many monuments all around the Islamic world. I couldn't give you lots of examples. Not only churches, but if you go in Iran, in one of the capital of the Iranians before Islam, which was Pasargah, you have a very important monument, Cyrus tomb, which become a mosque. So the phenomenon of transforming a church to a mosque in a new Islamic country is something very developed. It doesn't mean that all churches became mosque, and you have also, like Hagia Sophia, mosque becoming again churches. So, and when you see Damascus Mosque, we know through archaeological excavations that there was a Roman temple, and after the Roman temple there was a Christian church, and after the Christian, the beginning of the architecture of the mosque was the church. So it's very common phenomenon in history of Islamic civilization. So the second question about images of, in fact, it's the case of Christian images with Arabic calligraphy. As I told you, you had all over time in all this Islamic world some Christian communities. So those Christian communities spoke Arabic, but they were Christian. So they had, in a certain way, Christian art. It's something even difficult to understand for European people. And I could develop with some different examples, but I don't want to be too long. So I hope that you could understood my answer, even if it was not in Arabic. Shukran.
So before this department opens in 2012, the Met opens their own Islamic gallery in 2011. Then Berlin also opened.
Will open.
Is there something that actually connects why the big museums are opening Islamic galleries. Is there anything related to something that happened like in 2006 or something?
Yes, of course. It's in those projects are not coming out from nothing, and they are linked each other because of the international context. And in the metropolitan, the idea to design a new gallery for what they don't call Islamic art, but you can see they call Arabic, Iranian, and Turkish arts. They couldn't have the opportunity to take the term of Islam, but it was after the 21st September, of course, after the terrorist attack in Paris. The idea came from the President Chirac in 2003. To open, to put in the center, and it's right on an architectural point of view also, and symbolic point of view, to put in the center of the temple of universal culture, Islamic art. So it's everywhere, it's a political decision to enhance in a cross-cultural vision, Islamic culture in those universal museums. So, and we can see now that it's the same here also with a project of a museum of Islamic art. Why using museum for such a political question? Because museum is, from the beginning, is education. And we need education and to educate on what is universal culture, even with Islamic art.
I want to say that this Islamic art is part of the development that when Islam came out from the Arabic and meet the Persian, meet the Egypt. And by in the end of the story, I see that this dynasty is part of the guardian of the quote-unquote the Islamic art itself, because we have become the pioneer of Islam art and maybe the local culture before. Okay, then now this dynasty is all over. The Ottoman fell down after World War I, and then the Iranian fell in the Iranian Revolution. Is there still the evolve of the Islamic art right now in this country? Or maybe is there any community in Iran or in Cairo still produce Islamic art in these nowadays? That I see is only now, maybe it's my point of view is very narrow, only the calligraph still flourishing. How about the evolvement of the evolve of the Islamic art after the fall of those dynasties?
Your question is really very interesting and not easy to answer. I answer you like a political man. I first say it's a very good question and I don't have any idea how to answer you. But I think about during my... No, it's not the first time that some people ask me this question, and it's... So, is there any contemporary Islamic art? I would say yes, and it was part of your answer, yes, in some context. And I think what we can call today Islamic art is not the concept I try to explain you, which is a concept of the past, a concept of a very precise time of history and of art history, and from the beginning of Islam until 19th century. And part of your answer was because, of course, today we don't have everywhere kings or sultans or princesses that can develop such Islamic art. So where does it exist? Where does it not exist? Of course, when you go to Saudi Arabia, when you go to Arabic world, to Dubai, to Abu Dhabi, when you see those new mosques, there is still in religious context, you spoke about calligraphy, there is still a tradition of architecture, of manuscripts, religious manuscripts, that related to this Islamic art I could coming from the past. But when you are, and Cairo is a good example, you have a lot of artists living in Cairo. There is a very rich production. Even in Tehran, you have painters, you have photographers. Are those photographers in Tehran, because they are in the Islamic world, do they produce Islamic art? No. They are in a more international process. And it's maybe the difference with contemporary art. We could say this art that started after the Second World War, which becomes international. You do the same, or you have the same type of inspiration when you are in North America, when you are in China, in Japan, in Europe. You make video, you make, you have the same techniques. But of course, so the new international concept is not more an Islamic global concept next to a European global context. It's a real international concept. But inside this international concept, you still have regional reality. So you can speak about Moroccan contemporary art, you can speak about Egyptian contemporary art. You have specific styles because an artist is part of his inspiration comes from the fashion, the global fashion, and some comes from his own identity, his own cultural heritage. So I hope that I was a little clear.
Could you describe what is actually the size of the Islamic art collection in the Louvre, or how big is the display in the Louvre?
We have a new building that was built by an Italian architect inside a courtyard, because the Louvre is an old palace, and so we didn't build next to an old building, but inside an old building in the courtyard on two levels, and the total surface is 3,000 square meters on the two levels. And we have a collection of 21,000 objects, but we show only 3,000 objects. Because, as I told you, we have also to show Islamic art in the other Louvres, like in Abu Dhabi, in north of France, and we try also to make a lot of loans all around the world. But we have 3,000 square meters and 3,000 objects in exhibition. And I will not, of course I have images, but just trying to imagine the storytelling as we talked before. It's the presentation is in a chronological storytelling, but not in a dynastic storytelling, because the story of the dynasties in Islamic world is so complex. So we try just to have four important sections, chronological sections, and inside some geographical sections inside each chronological world.
And do you have high school students coming to the university?
Yes, we tried for the opening of the department to develop a lot of visual education tools inside the space. And we try to develop, of course, we have the so-called School of the Louvre with students. It's the only lesson on specific on Islamic art in Paris. And we try for a large audience in the Louvre auditorium to develop some specific programs also.
I'll do it in Indonesian actually. Yang masih belum puas, masih ada acara lain bersama Professor Lintz, international event oleh IF Paris untuk memajukan pertukaran gagasan dan intelektualitas dalam suasana yang lebih terbuka dan ramah tamah ya. Tempatnya di IFI Tamrin jam 6 sore, tapi kok tanggalnya nggak ada ya? Tanggal 26. Yang tertarik silahkan datang, harus daftar dulu atau? Nggak usah, bisa langsung datang aja kalau masih belum puas. Terima kasih semuanya.